Good evening and happy holidays, and welcome to Napa Valley Sessions. My name is Connor Best. On behalf of Napa Valley Vintners, thank you for joining us to explore the depths of food and wine pairing in Napa Valley. No matter what your plans are this holiday season, we hope this discussion helps you unlock new potential in your holiday meal. You can find past and future sessions like this one linked on our website, napavintners.com. Look for the Napa Sessions page. In fact, if you're interested, we have three sessions planned for January, exploring sustainability, viticulture, and winemaking. If you're a wine nerd, make sure to tune in. And now without further ado, I'd like to introduce today's host, Ray Isle. Ray is certainly no stranger to food and wine. A Texas boy who studied creative writing at Stanford in the Bay Area, Ray got his start in wine, there, visiting wineries and working the bottling lines for free wine. He soon combined his skill at writing and newfound passion for wine when he moved to New York City, where he began writing for Food and Wine magazine. Today, he's joining us from Brooklyn, where he lives with his wife and daughters, and in his words, his ridiculous cat. He's the executive wine editor for Food and Wine magazine and an editor for both Travel and Leisure and Departures. He writes frequently about wine, beer, spirits, and travel, and has been nationally recognized. Thank you, Ray, for joining us tonight. Take it away.
Okay, thanks, Connor. Yes, and then we're gonna explore not the depths of food and wine pairing, but the heights of food and wine pairing. This is gonna be fantastic. I'm really looking forward to this. I hope everybody out there has a glass of wine in hand, and I hope that I really hope it's a Napa Valley wine. That's what we're concentrating on today. Thank you, Napa Valley Vintners. And I'm gonna introduce our chefs in just a second. This is gonna be fun because what I decided to do was to talk about the question of like how wine pairs with food, how food pairs with wine, how people think about it, particularly chefs. I thought it'd be fun if we tasted these wines that we have tonight. As you can see, they're in little bags. They're blind. So the chefs do not know what they're tasting. And I thought it'd be great to get their sense just from, you know, the flavors and aromas of what they're tasting, how they would think about coming up with a dish to go with the wine. We'll reveal each wine as we go through it. This is not some kind of master sommelier test. I'm not going to quiz anybody about who the producer was or what the year was, just about flavors and how it makes you, how it inspires you as a cook. And I think because, you know, we should just go ahead and get started. I will say, you know, this has been a weird year. Everybody knows that. But wine is one thing that we have that, one, everybody's drinking a lot of these days, and two, really brings us all together and makes life happier, and food is the other side of that. And so I'm thrilled to welcome the three chefs who are gonna be with me tonight for this. Jammir Gray from Compline in Napa, in the town of Napa. And as I talk about you guys, you can appear magically. So I don't know if people have been to Compline. It's a wonderful wine bar and restaurant in downtown Napa. It's like everything these days. It's now a takeout place. It's now a wine store. It's now a, you know, they'll airship food to you. Who knows? You know, but that's what restaurants are doing to stay alive. And the wonderful thing is they are staying alive, which is really important. You were at International Smoke before moving to Compline. Up until July, interesting time to start at a restaurant, you know, but welcome. Thank you for being here. Our next chef is John McConnell of Clif Family Winery, who is there. And, you know, formerly of once upon a time of Terra, I believe in Napa Valley, and one of my favorite restaurants when it was around. And Clif Family, of course, is a wonderful winery. If you haven't been there, in addition to good food, they have wonderful bikes. You have bicycles you can rent. You know, we will all be traveling again. Literally everybody in this audience watching tonight will go to Napa Valley at some point. If you haven't been already, if you don't live there already, rent a bike, rent a bunch of bikes, go tool around and taste wine and then come back and eat John's food. It will make you better. And if I bump this table and knock over these bags, which are slightly unstable, you know, we'll just deal with it as we go. And finally, Christopher Kostow, who I've known for years at this point, because he was back in 2009, a Food and Wine Best New Chef. And I met him on the trip we arranged for the Best New Chefs that year in Napa, which involved like taking off in helicopters and going places. And he is the chef of Meadowood in Napa Valley, also of Charter Oak, lately of Charter Oak, I don't know, yurt festival or yurt service, whatever, anything to adapt. A truly amazing cook and a wonderful person as well. And Chris, thank you for being here.
Thanks for having me.
And first things first, to you guys, to everybody out there, let's just raise a glass and say cheers. Here's to the holidays. Here's to the end of 2020. Here's to a new year. And here's to good wine and food. And so that now that we've tasted that first wine, Chris, I'm just going to shamelessly go to you first because I know you best, and I don't have, you know, I don't have any doubts that you're going to have an answer. What is this? So, I mean, when you taste this wine, what does it make you think? And what does it make you think both in terms of flavor and in terms of working as a chef and how you would work with a wine?
My first impression is it seems like a pretty hands-off winemaking style. It's very yeasty. It's very, I mean, honestly, from at first approach, it almost veers more towards like a natty wine, which is, you know, a pretty rare thing and stylistically in the Napa Valley. In terms of pairings, I mean, my lack of proper vernacular and wine training leads me to sort of always cook with my gut and I, you know, more or less like putting flavors together. That's normally how I deal with wine and food pairing. So, you know, I something this yeasty, this sort of savory, like a fattier fish is something I would go towards, like a black cod, which is a fish that's very, very obviously common to Northern California. That was the first thing that kind of came to mind.
And what kind of preparation for it would you do?
That's a good question. I mean, I think there's enough fat in the fish, and I don't think this wine can hold up to like a super fat poached technique. Mm-hmm. So I think, grilling might be a little too much as well. I would just like a pan roasting of some kind, I think would probably suffice. Probably cured a little bit first, just because it makes all black cod better at every turn. Mm-hmm. But also I think from a textural perspective, it gives the fish a little more flake, and I can kind of see that working a little bit better with this wine.
So when you cure a black cod, what's your cure for it typically?
Just sea salt or kosher salt. Mm-hmm. We cure about, you know, 9 out of 10 fish that we use, we cure in some fashion.
Really? Okay. For how long?
I mean, a side of black cod, you know, depending on its size, aside from 10 to 12 minutes normally. Mm-hmm. Again, just to firm it up, I think it gives it a slightly, obviously, more saline, cleaner flavor. Right. And it stands up to cooking quite a bit better.
That's cool. So, obviously, everybody out there, A, doesn't know what this wine is, and B, doesn't have it in their hands. I will tell people that it is, it's pretty bright, pretty high acid wine. It's obviously white wine. It's obviously Napa Valley. Everything out here is Napa Valley today. And some nice citrus, and a touch of bitterness on the end. It's like a citrus zest or citrus peel kind of bitterness to me, which is that I don't know how you guys, and maybe the other two can jump in. Bitterness is one of those words that has a negative connotation, but can be a wonderful angle on a dish or in a wine. In fact, you say bitter and with wine, people are sometimes like, why would I want that? Do you guys think about that as a flavor component when you cook?
Oh, 100%.
Definitely. It's funny that you say that. It does have a little bit of sweetness to it, and that sweetness definitely will help out something that is a little bit more bitter. We actually have a winter citrus salad on our menu right now that has a lot of satsumas and caracara oranges, but we also have endive on it.
Okay.
So a little bit of bitterness, really, that bitterness and that sweetness really goes together really well. And it would, honestly, I think it would be great with whatever this is.
Winter citrus salad sounds good to me with this. And endive is exactly the kind of thing I'm talking about. My household is divided. I love endive. I think it's the best lettuce-like thing out there. And my mm-hmm. wife and daughter both think it's unpalatable and totally bitter and just rebel whenever I try and throw it in a salad. So same thing with radicchio. They're anti-radicchio, damn it. John, what would you create for a wine like this?
Well, I'm a fan of the outside the box pairings or suggestions. I'm always trying to find a niche that I could basically cause somebody to think twice about. So I think it's there's nothing wrong with paying homage to the classics and you know, I would say simpler fare. But in this case, you know, when you try this wine, it is a higher acid. There's like a little bit more of an apple tone, or like a bitterness that would come from like an apple skin. And I just can't help but to think of eating this with a nicely baked apple pie with a slice of melted white cheddar. It has to be white, especially from the Northeast.
Right.
Melted white cheddar over the top of this, and I'd be happy with those two.
So the sweetness of the pie wouldn't actually, that takes me back to a basic question, which is, why does cheddar work well with apple pie?
I mean, it's savory, and I think apples tend to, you know, have a fruit association to them, but they're not necessarily a fruit that definitely has a high acid profile or a lack of complexity. There's something kind of very comforting and familiar to an apple in terms of its texture, the metamorphosis of, you know, introducing it to heat, whether it's being baked, roasted, or even sauteed, and really kind of how it allows the inherent flavors of apples to become a little bit more expressive. When melded, you know, with something as, you know, savory and deep in flavor, complex as an aged white cheddar, or even just a basic aged cheddar, they just have an affinity for one another. Again, that's a more of a Harold McGee question. I'm sure there's some science behind that as to making sense of that pairing, but I've always felt it to be unique. And when you try it, you realize, oh, this does have some compatibility, and you just kind of gravitate towards ways of recreating that as a chef.
Yeah, and it's interesting because normally you wouldn't think a dry wine would go with a sweet pie, for instance. It sometimes will make the wine too aggressive, but with the cheese being in there kind of plays a middle role in some context for it. So why don't I reveal what this thing is, and we can talk about it a little more. This is wine number one, by the way. And this is Trefethen's 2019 Dry Riesling from Oak Knoll, Trefethen Winery. I've written about this wine any number of times. It's from some of the rare Riesling vines that still exist in Napa Valley. Unfortunately, reality being reality, you can get a lot more for a ton of Cabernet than you can for a ton of Riesling these days in Napa. But when Napa does dry Riesling well, Smith Madrone also does a beautiful one. It can be a really wonderful wine, and a wine that ages very nicely too. And I've always been a fan of this. And I also think it's interesting talking to you guys about it. I think people sometimes do worry about whether there's a right or wrong, like whether the food they're going to make is going to go badly with the wine, whether there's a right or wrong pairing. And at the moment we've got, you know, a slightly cured black bass. It was black sea bass, right?
Black cod.
Black cod, right. And a winter citrus salad and an apple pie with cheddar cheese, all of which will pair with this wine. What would be your advice to people out there in the audience who are amateur cooks or even like constant amateur cooks like me, because I cook all the time, in terms of thinking about pairing at home and thinking about wine and food at home? I mean, worry about it, don't worry about it. are there tips that are useful, you know?
Again, as I said earlier, I definitely lack the vernacular and refinement in terms of the ability to talk about wine in any way. But what I always find interesting is not trying to hit that home run pairing, but rather seeing how a wine corresponds with a variety of dishes that you're preparing and eating. It doesn't have to always work to be interesting and therefore to be good. So I think sometimes like we have to A, be willing to take risks and B, not expect perfection, but rather sort of enjoy the evolution of that wine drinking experience against a series of dishes. I always find that interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Jammir, what about you?
I agree. I don't think that anybody should feel real pressure to become like a master sommelier when they're trying to, you know, pair wines with food. I definitely think that a starting point would be, what do you like? Start there. I certainly wouldn't want, wine can be inexpensive, but I wouldn't want to spend money on something that if it doesn't pair with the food, I'm now stuck with this bottle of wine I don't like. So start with something that you like and then just work around from there, especially during the holidays.
Yeah, especially, and normally during the holidays, you're also dealing, less so this year, but you're often dealing with in-laws and relatives and so on. We may have wildly different tastes than you in both food and wine. And John, what about you? Like, what do you tell people when as a chef, when people ask you about wine?
Well, as cliche as it is, I think as a you know, country, we kind of lack an identity crisis in terms of, you know, identifying with traditions. If you look at every other wine region of the world, there is deeply rooted tradition where there is classics that have been derived from specific pairings. They've already done all the heavy lifting. We don't essentially have that in the US, but what makes us unique is that it's such a melting pot of diversity and cultures and how we can basically, you know, you're in Brooklyn, you can go anywhere down your neighborhood or a 2-block radius and get practically any cuisine you want. I think if we look to wine as a consumer, there's, you know, the world is our oyster. If you're constantly tasting and familiarizing your palate to what you like or what this wine embodies, what's your first gut instinct in terms of what you want to eat with it? Typically, I kind of start there. It's much more raw and kind of organic process. But, you know, if you've already selected that bottle and you essentially have an idea of what you would like to prepare with it, or maybe you don't, maybe you have a well-stocked pantry or larder, taste the wine. What is it summoning? What is it calling to your attention? And then go back and start to create your meal. And I think sometimes simple is best, especially if you're a home cook. If you are deciding to make a complex recipe, maybe that's the time spent is just to execute the recipe, and, you know, wine becomes slightly a bit of an afterthought at that point. But typically for me, especially as we've kind of derived now a schedule that's conducive to being at home more, I find the days where I'm spending some time doing admin at home where I might be opening a bottle, let's say 9, 10, 11 o'clock in the morning, and I'll kind of come back to that periodically. And as that wine starts to evolve, I'm starting to think, okay, well, what am I going to have for lunch? What am I going to have for dinner? So that typically kind of dictates the direction I take what I'm going to prepare, typically. But taste your food, taste your wine.
Which makes, taste everything. And I mean, and Jammir, I think you're right too. It's like, you know, eat and drink what you like. The analogy I always use is if I tell you that this Riesling goes best with trout, if you don't like trout, it doesn't matter in the slightest whether Riesling goes best with trout. I mean, if it's like me telling you, you know, hamburgers are better with pickles on them. You're like, but I don't like pickles. And I'm like, well, hamburgers are better that way. You have to eat them. But you think I was a jerk. it really should be approached as fun rather than anything else. But I do think that advice of tasting it, you know, almost no wine, unless it's a really old wine, is going to be disadvantaged by opening it a few hours early, tasting it, and then thinking about what it tastes like. I mean, open it, taste it, pop a cork in it, throw it back in the fridge, keep it somewhere cool if it's red, and then think about the food after that. Let's jump to wine number two.
Right. I have a great question that came in from the audience while we're still on wine number one. Valerie is wondering, when you're thinking of spicy foods, everyone says Riesling and Gewürztraminer. What do you think about those two, and how do they interact with the spicy food different?
Well, anybody want to leap in?
Sure. Yeah. So I think by default, those have always kind of been a catch-all category in terms of representing kind of what, you know, flavors of the East or Southeast Asia have. They are always kind of umami or savory rich dishes that tend to be well balanced. There's a lot of acidity. There's a lot of spice and other nuance to the cuisine. They definitely need something that kind of sweeps it clean and kind of refreshes your palate, because essentially it's not an assault on the palate, but there's a lot of flavors going on. And Riesling can provide at times slight off dry examples that really kind of stand up to the heat. So there's a reason why sweet and spicy go together. And that kind of caters to that. But beyond that, the acidity kind of makes the pairing slightly interesting or keeps it somewhat unique. And it's kind of the wash, rinse, repeat cycle. You know, you're eating a bite, you go back to the wine, it kind of cleans the palate, you kind of go ahead and do it again. I will say I've gravitated towards more of dry Rieslings in particular, and that becomes more of a stylistic approach that's now representing most of the marketplace. And those wines in particular do not stand up to traditionally spicy dishes. So that off dry, that residual sugar that was kind of left back and for balancing purposes is almost necessary the spicier the cuisine. So that's just my own unique or my own experience in those pairings.
I'd say one thing that's interesting. I was talking with a master of wine, Kim Cho Lee, who's Korean and lives in Singapore and writes for Hong Kong. I guess she's in Singapore right now. But she writes extensively about wine and extensively in China. And she was saying that, you know, one thing to remember also is that part of this is cultural, in that we were talking about Sichuan food and how, you know, that ma feeling of the numbing heat of Sichuan food. In China at least, that's partly what you want, is it's and in fact intensifying that is a good thing. and we tend to think of like choosing a wine that's slightly sweet that'll kind of mellow out that heat. Where she said in China, a lot of people want a big red wine that's going to intensify that heat because that's part of the pleasure of the dish. And so there are kind of cultural things that flow into this decision of what we like and how we like spice paired, for instance. Like, do you want to intensify it? Do you want to diminish it? The other thing that's interesting is that their palate chemistry is interesting too, because sweet food tends to diminish the sweetness in wine. It makes drier wine seem even more dry, and it makes sweet wine seem a little less sweet, which is why that Thai combination of sweet and sour and spicy will make a off-dry Riesling feel a little bit less sweet, but at the same time kind of mellows the heat. It's tongue chemistry is a really cool thing, weirdly enough. I think that's why I do what I do, I guess. Let's do wine number two. This is kind of a jump stylistically. John, I'm going to make you take the leap and talk about this one first. We're definitely in a realm of more unctuousness and more richness on the palate.
Significant jump in terms of texture and body in terms of this wine from one to two. This definitely kind of, I would say, is more on the floral side of things in terms of it has a kind of significant expansive mid palate, certainly a richness and a fullness about it. It's got a great sense of balancing acidity. And really, to me, it just kind of calls out to mind, in particular, a lot of seafood preparations. This is the time of year that I really get excited about seafood. So it could be, you know, mollusks or anything kind of harvested around the sea. Kind of going back, and a lot of people, Ray, this takes it off topic, but a lot of people are not aware of kind of traditionally the months to go out and actually enjoy some oysters. And I think those are the months that end in R. I think this is a conversation I keep having with folks. Oysters, maybe not so much in this case in terms of the traditional raw and the half shell, but certainly something like a fried oyster sandwich of some sorts, whether it's a po' boy or some type of fried seafood, for example, which kind of takes me back to closer, anywhere you go where they're harvesting seafood, there tends to be kind of a fry shack close by. And it's, you know, very simple food, but it's also quite delicious and refreshing with a lot of these styles of wine. So,
cool. Chris, what do you think?
It definitely screams shellfish to me. But for me, and I guess my mind goes to something even meatier, you know, speaking of seasonality, like a spiny tail lobster, like lobster in general, this would just crush, I think. But I think it could also go to some light poultry. Like I could drink this with roast chicken. I could drink this with roasted fish. You know, if you're applying a pretty aggressive cooking technique, you could do this with like root. I would drink this with root vegetables. Pretty much everything that's in season right now. This seems like a wine that's kind of perfect for right now.
Perfect late autumn, early winter wine. How do you do oysters at Charter Oak, right?
We do some oysters at Charter Oak. I mean, we do. But we also subscribe to the months of R as a general rule. Yeah.
I just remember a roasted oyster preparation or something. It struck me that when you're talking about roasted oysters, even with classic oysters Rockefeller or something, this could be a really cool wine. Jammir, where would you go with it?
Well, this actually reminds me of the tropics. It's screaming passion fruit butter, pineapple, guava, a little bit of green apple in there. Seafood, I would definitely go the seafood route. But it's definitely a little bit more intense than the first one. Mm-hmm. What it kind of reminds me of, it wouldn't just go seafood, like roasted or whatnot. This reminds me of my sister. Every year at Christmas, she lives in Chicago, and she has me freeze her Dungeness crab and then bring it to Chicago because they don't really do Dungeness crab out there. And she makes curry crab with it. And I think this would be perfect with it. And I'm sad I can't have these together.
That would be killing. Also, curry crab has that curry. There's a wonderful Indian restaurant named Ruchi about like a quarter of a mile that way through this wall that does a crab curry that's very creamy but has a fair amount of bright spice to it. And that would be a knockout with this.
And not necessarily spicy curry crab either. Like, yeah. More of a bite, so something from like galangal or ginger, lemongrass. But yeah. I like this one.
Delicious. Why don't we do a little reveal on it? And John, I'll give you extra star points if you can guess what winery it's from.
Well, that's a bit leading, Ray. So I'm going to go ahead and say this is a Clif family wine.
Very good.
Vintage 2008. Yeah, okay.
That's your master sommelier credentials right there. This is the Clif family winery, Viognier, Napa Valley Viognier. It's from Oak Knoll as well, actually, from Vineyard in Oak Knoll. It's interesting to me. This is in, if I'm remembering right, this is in neutral oak and stainless steel. So there's actually no new oak on this wine at all, which I think is one reason it works so well with shellfish. I tend to find oak doesn't love shellfish that much. But this does have that, I mean, like Jammir was saying, all that kind of wonderful kind of guava, passion fruit, mango, tropical notes to it. It's an interesting wine because it's unctuous, but it's also got, you know, really bright, really good acidity to it to back that up. I'm curious, when you guys cook, what role for you does acidity play in cooking? Is it a form of seasoning? Is it a backbone to a dish? Is it, you know, I know just from Food and Wine's test kitchen stuff that people talk about acidity a lot. And I'm kind of curious from the point of view of home cooks who are out there listening, how you guys think about acid in dishes.
I mean,
not sweet in acid, like 100%. When I was a kid, I was always told by my parents that I always over-salted something or over-peppered it. And that was because I could never figure out what it was missing. And I eventually realized it was acid. I actually got into a huge debate with the chef or the sous chef over at Blackbird in Chicago over which acid I prefer, vinegar versus citrus. But for the home cook, literally acidity, if you think something is missing, try the acidity, citrus, vinegar, and it really matters which one you add to your dish, because if you add citrus to a dish, it might not need those citrus notes from that you get from lemon or orange or kefir lime even. Mm-hmm. Like acidity is something very near and dear to my heart. And when it comes to my line cooks, that's one of the first things I teach them, because honestly, it cuts out a lot of the guessing work for them when they're trying to figure out what is this dish missing. It's right. You're missing acid.
Chris, what's your take on that?
I mean, I absolutely agree. You know, acidity, especially in a multi-course meal, or even when you're dealing with large plates of food, sort of keeps the palate engaged and keeps you interested. I think we all like fat in food. I certainly do. But the only way to sort of make it work long-term, as it were, is to make sure that there's a significant balance of acid. I tend to be very high acid in my cooking, mm-hmm. Which certainly presents issues with the wines of Napa Valley sometimes, certainly the larger reds. And I think to Jameer's point, we all have acids of our choice. I'm like a sherry vinegar guy, like forever. I use a lot of citrus. I worked for chefs. One of my mentor chefs was just like, was lime juice in everything. I mean, even things that would be seemingly incongruent. He's a very famous and well-respected dude. So I guess he knew somewhat what he was talking about.
Christopher, while you are answering that question, I have a question from Herb in the audience. When you're concepting your menu, how do you regard the potential food and wine pairings? Or do you just make the menu and then leave the food and wine pairing up to your wine director to figure out?
I could give the romantic answer that I'm thinking about the wine in any fashion, but the reality is I'm not. and I think that's a bit of, I mean, that's the truthful answer. There's enough to balance on my end in terms of what we're growing and what we're sourcing and what, I mean, all of that. I've always sort of subscribed to that idea of I'm going to put the dish together. I'm going to engage the wine director, and we'll work together at that point on the pairing. But I never, almost never, go into the ideation of a dish with the wine top of mind. Mm-hmm.
I'm going to guess, John, that you don't necessarily work that way, given that you are a chef at a winery, or at least that you might receive some flack if you work that way. But do you work from the wines sometimes backwards to the dish?
So this is, I'll try to keep this as summarized as possible. Both Chef Jammir and Chef Christopher basically represent like our approach to cuisine, right? Our goal is to craft something that is balanced, it's exciting, it's engaging, that you want to finish, right? That's our job as a chef. And understanding kind of your five basic flavors really kind of allow you to kind of create a dish to actually achieve that, that completeness. In this case, I'm actually looking at wine as one of those ingredients in terms of that's going to kind of, you know, this dish by itself is good, but it's missing something. And what really is that missing link is the connection to the wine. So I've had to adapt this philosophy into my cooking, which is completely foreign and backwards from, you know, my upbringing or time spent in the kitchen. But when you truly understand the interaction of how wine works with food and how you can use it as an ingredient, where it actually becomes necessary to kind of make those connections, that's where you're kind of unlocking a lot of potential. So I will say outside of the kitchen, I spend a significant amount of time enjoying wine, food optional sometimes, most times. But in this case, if you look to the wine as a ingredient or kind of a roadmap on how to achieve the desired effect, typically I'm connecting the dots after tasting the wine. So to me, that roadmap is completely different. But again, this is new adaptation or definitely a new philosophy to adapt into the cooking. But I think, you know, both Chef Jammir and Chef Christopher could both acknowledge that you're very comfortable at creating things, but to kind of reverse that psychology and taste something first to kind of, you know, complete the initial effect, that's part of a fun process too, because it's, I think we always want to be learning. And I think that really kind of helped me understand the potential of food and wine as it presents itself. So I'm excited to see that.
And Jammir, you work at, I guess, what you would call a wine forward restaurant in a sense. You know, I actually think that Compline and a lot of places like it are a kind of a movement in restaurants right now, or were up until everything was put on hold, of small scale restaurants that have been co-founded by sommeliers in a lot of cases that really push the wine part of the meal a lot, but have serious chef work going on at the restaurant too. And so I'm kind of curious how you take on that question also.
Well, to your point, it's exactly what you said. We have such a variety of wines here that you can't really work backwards unless you want to feature that wine for a dinner. I don't know if any of you have been to Compline, but our wine selection is extensive. They painstakingly like try all these different wines and decide whether or not you want to work with it or not. But because of that, it's really hard to just be like, oh, I want to work with this one. Let's try to make a dish off of it. It's like, okay, it's only going to go with that one, because some of them are very specific. Right. I know for me, when I am coming up with dishes here, I take more of the mind frame of making it wine friendly. So nothing is going to be extremely, extremely spicy. We want people to be able to explore and try different wines. And a dish that you would think would go with red wine, actually, there's also a white wine that would go really well with it. And our sommeliers on staff are really good with trying to make those connections for our guests. So definitely, I mean, I'm sure that if one day they brought me a bottle of wine and was like, can we come up with something for this one? Of course, but it's definitely more of the other way around.
Right, yeah, if you have 1,000 wines on the list, you'd better have dishes that go with more than one specific wine.
Yeah.
It, going back to something Chris said, it was interesting to me when you were talking about a particularly rich foods needing acidity to keep, you know, to keep your palate refreshed. And I've always said that, you know, wine is essentially a condiment in some ways too. I mean, it's more of how Europe tends to look at it. And wine is high in acidity. And it's one reason, and people tend to talk about tannins as a complement to fat and food, but acidity in wine is a hugely important complement to fat and food too. And weirdly enough, I mean, you wouldn't think to pair a Sauvignon Blanc with short ribs or something, but just in terms of brightening up your palate again, it worked fine. The flavors might be kind of weird. But it's that wine acidity is a remarkable tool, I think. Mm-hmm. I was thinking as we were talking about acidity and then we were talking about bitterness, do you guys have favorite umami sources? I tend to dump fish sauce into things that didn't necessarily need fish sauce, because you can put a little fish sauce in and suddenly there's some depth there that there wasn't before. And nobody says, oh, by the way, it tastes like fish sauce. So I'm curious if you have any secret weapon umami tricks for people.
Fermented food.
all fermented food.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
I'm basically the same boat. Well, number one, fish sauce. It's hilarious how many times you make something with fish sauce and people have no idea what that amazing flavor is. And oh, guess what? It's fish sauce. I'm also a fan of anchovies as well as black garlic. People use it, again, people have no idea where that amazing flavor is coming from. And then you're like, oh, it's black garlic. And then they freak out a little bit. They might not want it again, but the flavor was there.
And explain, because some people out there aren't going to know, what is black garlic?
Black garlic is a garlic that has been aged and to a point where, and fermented, ferments to a point where it turns literally black. And it just has so much potency. Like you can just take one piece of garlic and it will totally add so much flavor to that dish. And the aroma is insane.
It's like a little umami bomb.
On the menu pretty soon. Oh yeah.
Chris?
Also surprisingly good with truffles.
I would say at home, like I really like dried shellfish. Like my wife hates it, but like I like dried shrimp and things. There's like this Fuchsia Dunlop recipe that's literally like noodles, dried shrimp, and like charred green onion. It's like the greatest dish ever. And in the restaurant we do, we're pretty specific about, we make a lot of different garums, which are, you know, the same technique of a fish sauce using different proteins. And then we use that garum with that protein, i.e. we do like a beef garum that'll finish a beef dish, or a shrimp garum that'll finish a shrimp dish. So in the restaurant setting, it's a little bit more specific. At home, it's, yeah, dried shellfish. You know, we have a restaurant in China now, so I've been able to experiment with a lot of fermented chilies and stuff. So that's been interesting.
But basically, Meadowood is like going to ancient Rome then.
Well, it's more right now, it's more like Pompeii.
Yeah, okay, but fair enough. But it will come back. It's going to come back to ancient Rome. I'm very sorry that it's like Pompeii right now. It's not really a laughing matter, but you made the joke, so I feel like I'm glad that it. And yeah, if anybody out there doesn't know, there were some big fires this year in Napa. God willing, those won't be coming back. But you know, once we can travel, go support everybody in Napa. And in Sonoma and in everywhere in wine country. Let's try wine number three. And we're moving to red, because what would life be without red wine? Yep, this is wine number three. And a lot of richness, a lot of fruit. Jammir, I think you're first up on this one.
Yeah. So off the bat, jammy notes for sure. Dried fruits, really ripe blackberry. There's peppercorn, but it's not black peppercorn.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely, it's pink. Pink, maybe some black. But from this overall nose, I thought it was going to be a lot more tannic than what it is. It's not. It's definitely softer.
No, it's more on the fruit. It's very forward fruit, but without the sort of massive tannic support you get with Cabernet or something like that.
I'm sorry, what?
And it's got some lovely savory notes on the finish.
Yes, no, for sure.
Like rambly herbal things.
Molasses a little bit, pomegranate molasses.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's honestly out of the three, the other two are great, but this one screams Christmas to me.
Yeah. it's a Christmas, I got my Christmas lights, now I got my Christmas
No, for sure. I mean, honestly, just because of how fruit forward it is and how it isn't as big as I thought it was going to be, I think this would be really good with a roasted duck breast. Mm-hmm. We actually have one on the menu right now that has huckleberry, but I think any sort of fruit would go really well with this. Like blood orange.
Mm-hmm. Everybody's going to get off of this seminar and immediately go start going nearby.
Yeah, even like lamb, but lamb served with maybe like fruit, lamb with a pomegranate molasses, that'd be really good.
Mm-hmm.
I also feel like this is not just a food wine. I can see myself drinking this without the food.
Just hanging out by the fire, you know, with
exactly.
With as I have right now, because I'm in New York, snow, lots of snow falling outside.
Yes.
it's kind of a perfect wintertime warm you up.
It is.
Know, a cozy wine.
Yeah. It almost has the same effect that you would get from like a mulled wine, not necessarily temperature wise, but just because of like the spiciness. Like there's a little bit of allspice in there, clove, but then you have all those other fruits that are lending a hand in it. It's good. I like it.
Chris, where would you go with it?
I mean, definitely meat, but meat with a good deal of sweetness. It's sort of like right down the middle meats, barbecue, ribs, you know, burgers, maybe with some sweet element to them. I mean, this would obviously work with a grilled steak, but it lacks some of the greenness that maybe, I don't think this is a cab, but lacks some of that greenness that a cab has that I think works so well with a straight up grilled piece of steak. So yeah, definitely like a sticky rib.
Sticky ribs would be excellent. This is also, I'll point out, because I'm in New York, it's 8:45 or something, or 9, and I haven't eaten yet. So this is kind of torture. But I'm full of ideas at this point. And John, what about you? Where would you go on?
This to me, it's funny, Ray, because you poised this wine with a question initially. It kind of made me think about what wine we're going to be introduced to, because of course you're trying these wine. But when you said savory, and then you taste this wine, and oh, I understand the context. This wine to me is like a hallmark of what I would consider to be kind of like California's take on Zinfandel in terms of it having that warming kind of earthy savoriness. It's got warming spices. Jammir, basically you hit on every single one of those, and it's got a deep, dark, rich red fruit flavor profile to this, but it's got a great aromatic intensity. But to me, this really kind of summons what I would consider more along the lines of maybe Chinese in terms of like a stir fry, for example. And really it's kind of unlocking that umami potential, that savory quality. One of the things that we specifically do here, which is a hallmark to our menu and a staple because it's one of our owner's favorite, is we do a funghi bruschetta. And it's basically just an open face sandwich where we grill the bread. It's topped with a mixture of duck cell, which is basically the trimmings of the mushrooms. It's been stewed with wine for a long period of time. And that's actually added into some ricotta. And then we also have four different types of mushrooms that we cook all separately, intently to, you know, unlock the potential of the texture of the mushroom and its flavor peakness. And it's just accented with a little bit of melted fontina. But mushrooms in particular, significantly savory. And that's kind of nature's gift to us, right? In terms of unlocking savory potential or umami in food naturally. And it's not a fermented food, but it goes exceptionally well with this style of wine or Zinfandel in particular. I'm holding on to this Zinfandel. I hope I'm not wrong here.
We don't have to stop talking about it. I'll go ahead and reveal the wine because you know, you get additional points for nailing the Zinfandel in this case. It's a Robert Bialy, and it's the R.W. Moore Vineyard Zinfandel from Coombsville, 2018. My eyes.
Oh, you're right.
and. It is. I mean, I love Bialy Zinfandels. They make great old vine Zinfandels from a number of vineyards scattered throughout the area. They do a wonderful trick of balancing a fair amount of richness with a lot of spice and a lot and good enough acidity that it doesn't come off heavy. I mean, it's, you know, it's 14.8 alcohol. It's not a small wine, but it doesn't, you know, you don't feel weighed down by it. Your palate actually is fairly bright afterwards. And you know, it does. It is one of those interesting questions, though. It's like, you know, does, if you have a big wine, and realistically, Napa Cabernets are pretty big, and Napa Zins are big. You know, do you have to have big food with a big wine? Can you do something light and delicate with a big wine like that? Is that possible?
I would recommend no.
Fair enough.
Unless you want the wine to truly shine. Again, I'm also speaking through it with the lens of, you know, what does food do? Is it just satiating? Is it basically just satisfying an appetite? Do you really want the wine to really sing and be the rock star of that whole experience? So I guess it's really what you want of the pairing. In terms of matching it up to something that's enjoyable or unique or interesting, I would definitely try to match the body of the wine with something that maybe is a little bit bigger, bolder, mm-hmm. in terms of its flavor profile. And again, I'm a huge fan of the wash, rinse, repeat cycle. So if the functionality of the wine pairing really allows you to complete those three stages, and before you know it, your bottle's gone or the company's, you know, fed and the wine, now you need to open another bottle. I think then the success of the pairing kind of worked, right? Does it have to be the best? Does it have to be a home run? But everybody enjoyed themselves and it kind of completed what it was intended to do.
What do you guys
think? I think it's possible. Especially with this wine, since it is a little bit softer, by no means a light wine, I could see it. I mean, I guess it really depends on your definition of delicate, but I can see this going with maybe a pork or veal like meatball, mm-hmm. which would be more of an appetizer, of course, but or like a sweet and sour pork meatball. I have Hawaii on the brain right now. But I definitely think it, I think it's possible, especially with this one, because this one, I feel like this one is very, very friendly. This, I feel like this is a very food friendly wine.
Yeah, it to me it is too. Chris, what's your take?
I mean, I guess it depends. I think you can, I think it's sort of about the cooking technique you apply. Like a wine like this, I think you can do with a vegetable, be that maybe that's a pumpkin that's grilled, mm-hmm. or some sort of sweet element to it. So I don't think it needs to be something hefty per se, but I think the technique applied to it does need to be.
Cool. And actually that kind of brings up one question I've always like to ask, you know, chefs particularly, is like, I mean, have you had pairings before in the past that were just god awful? I mean, it's what's like, what stands out as a particularly bad idea to you?
Well, I think what we do, we spend a lot of time validating and verifying the work we do, whether it's working with our staff or just kind of ensuring kind of execution or constantly familiarizing and kind of keeping our skill and our palate sharp. We're always tasting, always kind of looking, watching, and observing. If something is immediately a no, like we know, okay, that's, we need to update this, time to phase it out, or, you know, whatever the case may be, when we know something doesn't work, there's no need to kind of force the square peg to the round hole. If you have a offensive wine pairing, it's an immediate no. There's really no course correct at that point. You just, I'm going to enjoy the food and then finish it, and then I'll go back to maybe try it enjoying the wine or vice versa. But if it's a horrendous pairing and it's just not very thoughtful, like clearly somebody just didn't do their legwork or the research to make sure that the end user, the guest, is actually going to enjoy that experience.
Right.
Super true. I can actually think of one time at a place I had done a chocolate hazelnut mousse cake, and the GM, I believe, he just instantly thinks that desserts go with sparkling wine. And so he put a sparkling rosé with it as the pairing. And I remember trying it and it was so upsetting. It just didn't go. And I love sparkling rosé. I love my chocolate hazelnut mousse cake, but together it was just, it's like, you can't even like will it to work.
Yeah, it just, I mean, oh. Certainly killed the wine, I'm sure.
It did, and that was one of my favorite desserts that I had ever come up with, and it was just, I remember that forever. That's
bad GM.
Yeah.
Chris?
You know, I can't remember a specific dish. I remember in the early years at the restaurant Meadowood when we did this wine event, the 12 Days of Christmas, and in the early days, there was a wine partner, a Napa Valley Vintner, that would do all the wines for that meal. And for the most part, they're pouring a lot of cabs. So I'd have chefs from Scandinavia, well-known people who weren't gonna be told what they were gonna cook. They were gonna be like, this is what I'm cooking. And just watching the process by which guests would eat, you know, the lightly grilled mackerel and then drink like a young cab, and just watching like over eight courses, just people not enjoying it. I took a lot from that experience.
I take it that's no longer the structure for those meals.
Because of that, frankly, after a few years, we just curated our own pairings and it made a lot more sense for that reason.
I can't really see like Renee Redzepi saying, okay, fine, I'll just make a menu that goes.
It was a lot of that. Yeah.
Yeah. This is not necessarily stuff that people run into at home because they're not inviting famous chefs to their house to cook, you know, but it is true that some things don't mean, oily fish and tannins are not a great combination. Artichokes mess with your palate in a way that can be hard to pair wine with. But I always say to people that, you know, the truth is that wine also goes generally, broadly, goes better with food than almost anything else we drink. I mean, certainly it goes better than, you know, Coca-Cola or milk or, you know, orange juice. You know, if you want broad pairing ability, any one of these wines on the table is going to go better than those three things. Which is why we love the stuff. You know, I'm kind of curious what, and this is a purely biographical, but what made each of you want to become a chef? Do you still want to be one?
I was going to say, it's pretty hard to think about that right now, to be honest with you. For me, I started very, very young. I really enjoyed the order of the kitchen and the team element, the immediate gratification of the guest response, and sort of how kitchens and restaurants were these self-contained ecosystems. And I always found that very, very interesting. Mm-hmm.
John, what about you?
Well, I grew up in the Midwest. My dad was a manufacturing engineer, so we relocated a lot as a child. I was always often asked if we were in the military, but it was just my dad's job that took us from state to state. But I could only really kind of call my identity of kind of my upbringing as, to the Midwest. And it's not reputed outside of, urban areas like Chicago or Kansas City. It was never reputed to be a culinary destination. It's kind of middle America, agricultural driven and supported. And the irony for me growing up in some of these states is the agriculture that it was supporting wasn't really intended for human consumption. So the more you kind of understand the process where your food's coming from, and I'll, bless my mom, and my dad, sorry if you're watching, but they were just miserable cooks in the kitchen, and they would find a way to kind of just take the thrill out of eating to an extent where you kind of just write that off as an item. So I've kind of started with cooking not stacked in my favor. It was really an occupation that I really unlocked when I was in high school and didn't really see it as a career path until I withdrew from being a chemical engineer of all things. But when I was able to kind of find the thrill in the kitchen and what that meant and the hospitality element and how it all kind of comes back full circle and essentially kind of just finding a reason to understand, to connect more so with the land, it was really kind of this selfless idea of sharing this experience or sharing my knowledge in a setting that allows me to be creative. And I think that was really kind of where food was born. So I jokingly tell my mom and dad, it was so polarizing as a child to only be, fixated on certain meals that I was compelled to a kitchen to, in a pursuit or an interest to find better, greater cuisine. And that's why I chose this field. But I could honestly look back and say, I'm essentially where I should be, especially being in a wine region as great as Napa Valley. And obviously it's great reputation for amazing eateries and restaurants in this culture. So that's kind of what landed me here today. So I hope I represented that somewhat well.
I would say so. Jammir, what about you?
Mine is actually like a legit story. My story is kind of the opposite from Sean's, because my mom was Filipino, my dad was Black, and they both cooked all the time. And I was always the one who wanted to cook with them. I wanted to go to the farmer's market. I was like, my first book at the book fair when I was like 7 was a cookbook. I had to have it. Punishment for me was to not let me go into the store. instead of being grounded, you can't go to the farmer's market.
Or for you.
But I was also the artistic one, especially in school, to a point where my teachers when I was in elementary school would actually buy me supplies because they wanted to help foster that. And I remember when I was in the 5th or the 6th grade, I remember the exact path. I was at Kaiser Hospital and I was looking at a magazine and it was about Jacques Torres. Mm-hmm. And it was talking about how he was a culinary artist. And I just remember it clicked. It was just like culinary, I love cooking. Artist, I'm artistic. I should be a chef. And I've literally been on the same path ever since then. And that's how I became involved in this industry. I started going to college fairs and looking up the culinary schools, became hellbent on going to the CIA, like ever since I was like in middle school. So it was pretty, for some people, a lot of people have a not so straight path to get where they wanted to go and they had to like figure things out. But for me, it was definitely like, I want to be a chef. What do I have to do?
Right. That was the truth. And have you ever met John Torres and told him?
I did. when I was in culinary school and me and my friends went to his bakery in New York and my friends knew the story and they were like, you have to meet him. let's find out if he's here. I was like, no, I don't want to bother him. And he was there. So I have a picture with him.
That's great. Well, this is super. Connor, do we have any other questions from the viewers out there that they?
We actually have two great questions, yeah. And I'll pose them both at the same time, and then whoever wants to answer them can answer them. But we've talked a lot about fish, so the first question is there a fish preparation that will pair with a big red wine? And then second question, and I think each of you could answer this, it's your last meal, what's your dish, and what's your Napa wine that you're pairing with it? So go ahead.
I'll start.
Someone leap in, or else we'll just sit here and say.
So fish preparation with a big red wine. I think to borrow a little bit of our previous conversation, if you take a fatty fish that's already deep and full in flavor, something like a salmon, for example, or even king salmon, which is not necessarily farmed or artificially farmed, and you apply a salt technique or a salt cure to that to basically expel and firm up the flesh and really kind of intensify as it's enhancing its inherent depth of flavor, and do a cold smoke preparation that you could also in turn kind of create contrast in temperatures in terms of searing one side or gently warming it, even though it was a cold smoked salmon per se, as a nice meaty steak. And as if you can adapt a sauce that kind of bridges the gap there in terms of like a demi-glace or a rich red wine jus that would otherwise help satiate or pair, bridge that gap in terms of a pairing. And then having it slightly offset with something kind of sweet and earthy, similar to like a potato or Jerusalem artichoke. You need kind of some other rounded flavors to really allow that to sing. So I would explore that in terms to see what its potential is. So that's that's a complicated answer to the original question. Last meal, I often role play this a lot, and I typically gravitate back towards the same answer, fried chicken and champagne. And if it's not champagne, because we're talking Napa Valley, I'm certainly going to, selflessly produce a non-vintage sparkling rosé, I would likely have something like a vintage Stromsberg Blanc de Blanc to go with that fried chicken pairing. So that's my desert island final pairing.
So wait, they're going to kill you on a desert island? That's brutal. Is your final meal on a desert island?
Deserted, I suppose.
anybody else want to leap in on either of these?
When it comes to a preparation of seafood, that probably wouldn't go with a big red. Honestly, when it comes to, I'm thinking more about cooking technique, things that should be cooked delicately, like a scallop or a shrimp. I don't see those things being poached in it going even with the Zinfandel that I really do love. But there are plenty of other seafoods that will go with reds. A lot of people think that seafood shouldn't be served with a red, or it's too complicated and they don't want to deal with it. And I know that a lot of restaurants actually will follow that model, and it really does a disservice to a lot of the winemakers and the chefs that put a lot of thought into that. You should really don't be afraid to go against the norm when it comes to seafoods and wines. Although, like we said, some of them, if something's too acidic or too spicy, this won't work. And like I said, with the cooking technique, I really don't think like a poached scallop, like salad or dish or even pasta would go with any sort of big red. As for final meal, so like I said, I'm half Filipino. My final meal would be a dish called palaba. It is a rice noodle dish. It has a shrimp, a noddle sauce on it. It has a lot of seafood on it. It has shrimp, it has scallops. It has calamari, scallions. It actually also has some ground up chicharron on top. And when it comes to a wine, see, this is the part where I'm like thinking about it. I've never thought of a wine going with palaba, although a lot of things could go with it.
It's gotta be value.
Yeah, like tons. Honestly, the dry Riesling would be really good. But if it's my last meal, I'm gonna drink a whole bottle of Amarone separate from the palaba, because I've never met an Amarone that I didn't like.
Cool. And Chris, yeah, thoughts on either?
In terms of last meal, I mean, those of us not in a, in a city right now, those of us in Napa, because we can't travel, I miss all food so much right now. It's, you know, it's crazy. It's kind of hard for me to think about what that last meal might be. Might be maybe because just we were talking about today, like Russ, you know, Russ and Daughters, you know, just like a Russ and Daughters spread with bubbles sounds pretty good right now. So yeah, I mean, something Schramsberg is kind of our if we're sticking to Napa Valley, is our options, but a big spread of Russ and Daughters sounds pretty good right now.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, I'll jump in on this too, just partly because I did this the other night. There's a pretty good recipe from Esca that you can track down on the web, Esca in New York, that is a wild salmon that's poached in a port and red wine sauce with morel mushrooms. Ideally fresh morels, but you can use dried morels and fingerling potatoes. And that's a really good example of a fish dish that works perfectly with red wine, particularly in this case with Pinot Noir, the older Pinot Noir, but it has the oomph to stand up to you know, a pretty big red wine, and it's a lovely fish dish. My final meal, it's really simple. I'd just like to have dinner with you guys. I'd like to be able to cook dinner, yeah, have dinner with you guys. Whatever you cook, that's good by me, is my final meal. I'm cool with that. So I'm gonna say that's it for me.
Well, it's your final meal, Ray. You don't have to worry about doing the dishes, right?
That's right. Yeah. The final meal, definitely no dishes. That's really harsh. You have to do the dishes. Yeah. I also have planned, it's my final meal. I'm not going to be particularly sober at the end of it either. We're kind of at time here. I want to say thank you to you guys for showing up for this. This has been fantastic. It's not quite eating at all of your restaurants, but it feels almost like it, which is pretty cool. We will get to travel again. We will get to dine in restaurants with our friends again. We will get to, you know, hang out in groups, again. And when we do, we'll all, everybody out there who's watching this and everybody who's on this screen with me will be able to see each other and eat food together. And it's fantastic. And with luck, it'll be in Napa Valley. So that's the plan. Connor, do you have things you want to say to wrap this thing up?
Thank you so much to all the chefs, and thank you to Ray for joining us tonight to lead this discussion. We really appreciate it. And go out and drink Napa Valley wines.
Cheers to everyone, and thank you everybody out there who I can't see for attending. It's great to have you here.